Hello, I'm Matthias from Google. I'm a software engineer in the Android systems team here in London. 4 years ago, I joined, and since then, I focused on the GKI process and how we can support it with tooling. But more to all of that a little later. This talk should give a fundamental understanding of how Android is using the Linux kernel as base for the Android operating system. How kernels were and are developed in AOSP and across the partner ecosystem. I will talk about the generic kernel image, GKI, its motivation, and a little bit about its design principles. First of all, I would like to introduce you to the Android Common Kernels, ACK, as it's commonly abbreviated. The ACK are based on the Linux kernel, and hence all Android kernel development happens as a fork of the upstream kernel. In other words, downstream of the kernel.org releases. Those releases include the ones done by Linus Torvalds, release candidates, as well as full releases. Additionally, and relevant for the actual binaries on devices, we ingest long-term support, LTS, kernels. The difference between ACK and the upstream kernel is just what is needed to run an actual Android stack. A bit of build system integration, binder, scheduler, and other areas of the kernel. In total, a bit more than 100 patches, which sounds a lot, but if you look at them, there are actually not so many patches anymore. There used to be many more that were out of three differences. All development happens in public only, in AOSP. That includes the merges, as well as any patches contributed from partners or the community. The result forms the base for every Android device, and we are talking about over 3 billion active devices right now. As much as we love contributions, we like them to go upstream first. We strongly encourage and support the community and partners to upstream patches into Linux mainline first. That way, they are aligned with upstream. They are maintained as part of upstream development. They can receive tree-wide improvements, and automatically, obviously, they are part of every Android kernel tree. We accept contributions for Android-specific features, like, for example, dimension build system integrations. We also accept backports for upstream features, if reasonable, according to our contribution guidelines. Again, all development happens in public. Even the build and test infrastructure is publicly accessible. There is no secret source for building or developing kernels. And everything is publicly documented on source.android.com. As a result, in 2022, the ACK, the Kernel Common Project, was the AOSP project with the most non-Googler contributions. This slide gives a simplified overview of how code flows in AOSP from upstream to release branches downstream. The starting point is the upstream Linux kernel master tree, also referred to as mainline Linux. Every release candidate and release gets merged into Android mainline, usually within days. Android mainline can run on devices like Pixel 6 for development purposes, and we try to keep it that way. Every time we merge from upstream, every time we touch Android mainline, we are actually running on real hardware like the Pixel 6 for verification. Whenever there's a yearly LTS release, usually the last one in the year, we also create corresponding Android version development branches. For example, when 5.10 was created and that release merged into Android mainline, we forked Android 12 5.10 away. Similarly with 5.15. which forked into Android 13 5.15. After that, those branches receive timely merges from the LTS release that is cut at the same time. Timely meaning we expect an LTS release of every branch to happen roughly once a week, and latest a couple of days later, we actually have it incorporated in our branches. Eventually, after stabilization and possibly some more feature development specific for that Android version, a release branch is cut. That branch is used to build the binary that ends up on every device. Some years ago, this model was rather a recommendation, and we faced heavy kernel fragmentation in the field. Every device forked off, say, Android 13.5.15 at some point into a completely own and separate kernel tree. This made it hard to get kernel updates and fixes, like security fixes, into the field. Kernels appearing on new devices were already years old. Around 2018-2019, we started addressing this problem with the GKI program. Having addressed Android platform fragmentation with Project Treble in Android 8 by separating vendor bits from core Android bits, we tried to apply a similar philosophy to the kernel development. By separating again vendor bits from core Android bits or from core kernel bits. That way, we can make the kernel part of the Android platform that is common to all devices with all the development and releasing benefits. We can address fragmentation, updatability, and eventually we can release fixes, including security fixes, at a much higher pace and scale. Lastly, by getting devices on newest kernels, we encourage our upstream first philosophy in development and in innovation. GKI kernels contain facilities to allow the partner ecosystem innovation while protecting their IP, while still using a common kernel code base for every device. Unreleased hardware booting with open source kernel used to be fascinating and mind-blowing, but nowadays it's actually the default that happens all the time. The architecture of GKI is fairly simple. The generic kernel and the GKI modules are originating from ACK from a single source, and vendors develop against the API of the GKI. The APIs to the Android platform, the kernel userland API, are kept stable. That is a Linux principle. The APIs and the APIs to modules, on the other hand side, provided by vendors are kept stable, the KMI, the kernel module interface. That is not an upstream principle. It is very much breaking all the time. But an Android-specific guarantee we give for the GKI kernels. There is quite sophisticated tooling to ensure the API stability of those interfaces. I will say some words more for that later. Those guarantees eventually allow independent kernel development of GKI and vendor parts. In theory, we could even update the kernel and the modules independently. Though that's actually not something that happens in practice, as everything comes bundled from the vendor. Now, let me give you a little bit of an overview of how we got where we are actually right now. In 2016 and earlier, we can consider everything as unregulated, heavily fragmented. 2017 was when some restrictions were introduced, like the minimum kernel LTS versions. So vendors had to use a minimum LTS version for the kernels that they use. Android Pi marks the first time vendors are supposed to have their kernels downstream of ACK, basically forking from the Android Common Kernel. And as mentioned in 2019, we started the GKI work. As a first milestone of that, in Android 11, we released GKI 1.0. Released devices needed to be compliant with GKI. That means devices needed to be able to swap out the release kernel against the ACK GKI kernel under test. That way, partners could do all the modifications in the device kernel as long as the kernel was compatible. 2021 marks the year that devices started shipping with Google build binaries. Again, all publicly built on our public continuous integration system. One of those devices was the Pixel 6. At the release, the Pixel 6 kernel came with Android 12.5.10. What was remarkable was that 5.10 was at that time the newest LTS kernel released. It was less than a year ago. In 2022, we can see that the GKI model is now largely adopted in the partner ecosystem and branches predating GKI are getting deprecated. In 2023, and Android 14, you can see us already working on AOSP, on improving developer experience, the partner integration even more, and our tooling. This chart gives an overview of the adoption of kernel branches on released devices in the field. The absolute scale is not really of relevance, but the relative scale is. As you can see, Along the process of developing GKI, kernels reach the field with decreasing delay. As mentioned, 5.10 in the field was available less than a year after the upstream release. As we know, newer kernels are usually better supported and also receive updates longer. What also sticks out in this chart is obviously 5.10, with the strongest early adoption rates. But another interesting fact to notice here is the adoption of 5.4. Android 12 could be launched with either 5.4 or 5.10. And partners dominantly picked the younger kernel, leaving 5.4 behind. Finally, let me give you a brief overview of how GKI is developed. In order to achieve the GKI goals, such as updatability and innovation, and to support the single source, single binary approach, some technologies needed to be developed. First of all, we needed to ensure a hermetic and deterministic build. Without that, any guarantees about binary stability are just unreasonable. But more about that in a second. Next, we needed to ensure we are able to verify our GKI stabilities in terms of ABI stability for the KMI, but also in terms of testing. By defragmenting the kernel sources, the introduction of general large-scale testing really made a difference. Lastly, a lot of energy went into creating interfaces for vendors that allow the usage of the single kernel for everybody, while at the same time, we offer the flexibility to use the kernel for a multitude of different devices powering Android. Hermetic builds are essential not only for the stability of the GKI kernel and its ABI, but furthermore, a consistently and well-defined build system allows adoption in the community and partner ecosystem. Consider the various different system setups on development and infrastructure machines and how they possibly influence the outcome of the build result. As a result, when building GKI kernels for Android, every single input is declared. Sources, tools, everything is accounted for. A fixed configuration is part of the build definition. Any changes to it are subject to scrutiny and review and testing. We use Bazel to orchestrate the kernel builds and sandbox environments to isolate from the host. It should not matter when and where a build is made to yield the same result. And as a matter of fact, we hardly see any bugs that we cannot reproduce in our lab. The ABI, or KMI, can change due to various reasons. There could be actually breaking source code changes, configuration changes, or tooling changes. Either of them can be very subtle. In order to ensure the ABI stability guarantees of KMI, sophisticated tooling is in place. We do static analysis of the final binary. Based on extracted ELF and dwarf information, we compare the ABI representation of a candidate kernel with a proposed patch against the representation of a base representation of a committed kernel. We use fairly complicated type graph comparisons in order to identify differences that sometimes are subtly introduced. We are developing a tool for general ABI analysis, not only for kernels, called SDG, Symbol Type Graph, for this purpose. And of course, the sources are available in AOSP. Since GKI was a paradigm shift, not only for Android, but equally for vendors, in collaboration with partners, we developed facilities to allow a transition into the GKI model. Arguably, the most effective one is the introduction of vendor hooks. They are a callback mechanism via ftrace that allows almost arbitrary hooking into core kernel code via loadable modules. As a result, partners contribute locations where hooking is beneficial for them and gaining the flexibility needed. As a side effect, we see discussions spinning off vendor hook contributions that sometimes lead to upstream contributions making their vendor hook obsolete in the long run. We require partners to contribute their use cases of the KMI in terms of symbol lists that describe what symbols their modules require from the core kernel. That way, we gain visibility what areas of the kernels are in use, and we also are able to restrict the ABI that we have to keep stable to just the bits that are used on actual devices. Over time, we naturally created feedback channels with partners, and what used to be a Google-only development project is now a community project with partners contributing not only to the kernel itself, but also to the tooling. Like, for example, our new driver development kit that we are releasing for Android 14. Thank you very much for your attention. I hope that was an interesting talk and gave some insights into how the Linux kernel is used within Android, powering several billions of devices. Thank you very much. Goodbye.